evening. It is indeed a pleasure to be here among so many kindred spirits and to welcome Starhawk to speak to us. I first encountered Starhawk on the pages of Ms. Magazine in the 80s, where she was identified as someone who is working on behalf of the environment and labeled an eco-feminist. I later encountered her writing and her work in a course called Cakes for the Queen of Heaven, which really took a look at divine feminine and gave me a whole new sense of what spirit meant, one that really resonated deeply with me. And then I heard about these retreats that Starhawk was part of, and I asked that she was doing a workshop on Earth Day in Toronto, Earth Day weekend. And I asked my friend Margaret, hey, you want to go? Starhawk's coming. And she said, sure. So off we went, and we had a transformative weekend. It really opened our eyes and filled our hearts, stirred the fire within us, touched deeply into the wells of our compassion. And I can't think of a better role model for someone who, like many of us, care about the earth, care so in a deeply spirited way, and wants to engage in action to make the earth a better place. Starhawk is a person who does that, who embodies that, who enacts that, and it is my pleasure to welcome her to speak to all of us this evening. Please join me in welcoming her.
In the next decade are going to determine the future of human civilization and the future of the Earth and the climate of the Earth and the survival of species for hundreds of years to come. And we are desperately in need of visions and ideals and values that can take us out of the path that we're on right now and pull us into a different kind of future. So I think it's important to go back and think at this time about Brighid, who is old and also new. Today I'll be showing you some wonderful art by a friend of mine named Donald Engstrom, who's done these Brighid prayer plaques, which I like very much. And I'd like to begin by saying, may we all open our hearts and hearts to the blessing of Brighid. So Brighid, it is many things. She is the holy well and the sacred flame. She is the smith, the goddess of the forge, and the goddess of the cauldron, the goddess of sacred inspiration, of poetry and of healing. She holds the sacred flame, and her priestesses and later her nuns maintain an eternal flame and kildare for centuries and centuries, a flame that was actually relit in 1993 by the Brigantine nuns and continues to be kept alive today, which I find hopeful. She is the goddess of fire and also of water, the holy well, the sacredness of the water, the well that is the source of life and also the source of inspiration, and the sacred flame. I think we need Brighid today because we live in a time where water and fire have come to mean something very, very different, and where we have forgotten as a culture that they are sacred. And by sacred, I don't mean something that we, you know, bow down to and just worship. By sacred, what I mean is what's sacred to us is what's really important. Something that we care about so much that we don't want to see it messed up. We don't want to see it destroyed. We don't want to see it defiled. Something that's more important to us than our convenience, our profit, our personal comfort. Sacred and sacrifice are related, and if something is sacred, sometimes it's something we might make a sacrifice for. So when fire and water are sacred, when we really understand their importance, I think we would be living in a very different world than we're living in today. Because today we're living in a world where fire is the fires of Fukushima, the nuclear fire, the fires of the oil industry and the oil spills, the tar sands, the defiling of water, even the underground aquifers that comes with fracking, and the floodwaters that are the result of climate change, which is leading us to a world that looks more like this. So I think this is a moment where all of us could stop and ask ourselves, what would Brighid do? What would Brighid have to say about the drought in California that we've been suffering where I live, and its relationship to this rash of violent murders of young men and some women of color by our police force? How are they related? Anyone want to guess? I think they're related because of this, because centralized power likes centralized power. And I think that is the thing that we need to contend with. We are suffering from two great crises right now, the crisis of climate change and the crisis that involves this concentration of power and wealth in fewer hands. And they are actually the same crisis. effects of that concentration of wealth and power and the vested interests of the oil and gas industry. And so being here in Canada and in Ontario, I feel that it's a good time to really look at that question and look at why centralized power requires that level of force. And I think it does because of its basic understanding that what it's going to face is rebellion. That people really don't want to see the land polluted. They really don't want to see the lives of their children taken away. They really don't want to see the pipelines going across their lands. The Indigenous people have, the First Nations people have been standing up against this and have been the forefront of the resistance, especially here in Canada. I really want to honor the lead that they have taken in all of this. And to say that they are also in many, many ways the ones who are on the forefront, the ones who are suffering the most immediate impacts of the destruction. So this is what happens when people rebel, and this is what happens when people don't. We are in a place where really, if we continue, there is a Native American saying, says, if we don't change our direction, we're going to wind up where we're headed. So I want to take a moment and let us actually call in Bridget. You know, it used to be I would go places and people would ask me to talk and I would just talk. But now we live in a multimedia universe and it's, you know, I always feel like, oh, I can't just talk, I have to have a PowerPoint. And it's not just enough to have a PowerPoint, we've got to have a sing-along PowerPoint. So the sing-along part just goes like this.
Don't call it austerity.
Austerity is the frame that they like to use. Because when you say austerity, you think of something that's somehow sort of noble and lean and, you know, all the frills and the frivolities and the unnecessary luxuries you're done away with. But that's not what they're really talking about. What they're really talking about is theft. It's taking pensions that people work for in good faith and taking it away from them. You know, people who did things like fought fires or taught children or worked in hospitals or maybe tried to keep order in the streets because somehow actually giving them a comfortable and secure old age is something that the richest nations in the world can't afford because, again, those resources need to be siphoned off to make the rich even richer. Again, I ask, what would Brighid do? I think Brighid would be very familiar with the system. Graeber says we should, instead of calling it austerity, we should call it what it is, it's neo-feudalism. And, you know, Brighid, who was notorious for giving things away, you know, giving away her father's wealth, and giving, taking a king's jeweled sword and giving it to a leper to buy food. You can think of Brighid as the patron saint of income redistribution. But Naomi says this, you know, that the task that we have is not technological. We have the technology that we need. It's not impossible to make the shift. The shift that we need to make is a shift that is political, and above all, it's a shift in consciousness, a shift in spirit, a shift in values. And we need to actually reaffirm those values that I think have been the linking values, again, for every religious tradition, whether it's Christian or whether it's pagan or whether it's Jewish or Muslim, all of them, the core talk about our need to take care of one another, be responsible for one another, and take care of this beautiful earth that we have. And she says, fundamentally, the task is to articulate not just an alternative set of policy proposals, but an alternative worldview to rival the one at the heart of the ecological crisis. Embedded in interdependence rather than hyper-individualism, reciprocity rather than dominance, and cooperation rather than hierarchy. So, what would Brighid do? Brighid would tell us to treasure the waters, that the waters that move through the earth are a blessing, are an incredible sacred miracle, and that the tar sands and that the things that defile the waters should really be something absolutely unthinkable to do. That this is not just a money question, it's not just an economic question. Fundamentally, it is a deep moral question, and that we need to reassert the morality that says taking care of the world, taking care of the earth, taking care of those great blessings, whether you see them as the blessings of a goddess or the blessings of God or the blessings of some impersonal force of nature, that fresh, clean water is a miracle. And to destroy it and defile it, to turn the boreal forest into the desert, is really what we have to call a modern day sin. So 11 million liters a day of water are polluted in the tar sands. And more than 95% of it is so polluted that it can't be cleaned up and put back into the natural water cycle. There are tailing ponds that cover huge amounts of areas where that water is sequestered behind enormous dams that could break and pollute enormous areas. And the people downstream And the fish downstream are suffering from all kinds of cancers, anomalies, tumors, destruction. So what do we do? How do we transform the oil slicks of the water back into something that's clean and something that's pure? I think some of what we need to do is to know what the solutions are. And to know that there are solutions and there is hope. So I want to, among the other things that I do, I am a permaculture teacher and designer. I teach a whole system of ecological design. I also have a ranch where we're putting some of this into practice, and I also work with groups in the city where we're putting it into practice. And I know that there are solutions, even to our most dire environmental crises. So I don't want to continue to spend the whole evening inflicting horrible pictures and tar sands upon them. I want to talk about what are some of the things that we can do to create a world where our children and our grandchildren are going to enjoy these beautiful, clear waters, where we're going to enjoy a world of biodiversity and a world of thriving life. And for that, I think we need to turn to Brighid of the Flame, Brighid of the Forge, the flame of imagination. I mean, what would it be like if we replace scarcity thinking with the goal of creating as much abundance as possible? Because I think some of our issues come from this sense of fear that there's not enough to go around, and therefore I gotta get more. And I gotta get more, and I gotta get enough, and I'm gonna get so much that I'll have a bulwark against any possible lack. And I think what Brighid tells us is generosity creates abundance. And that abundance is not just about amassing of stuff. It's not about numbers on a balance sheet. It's not about the mini mansion and the SUV. Abundance is about everybody having enough. It's about sharing. It's about living in a world where we all have clean water, where we all have good, healthy food to eat, where we can go to bed knowing that there aren't children starving down the street from us or on the other side of the world from us. That to me represents abundance, and I think that's the kind of abundance that is represented by the generosity and the compassion and the love of Brighid. So we need safe renewable power. And the good news is we actually have many forms of safe renewable power. And we don't, you know, it would be nice to have miraculous new inventions and brand new technologies, but with the technology that we have right now today, we actually could make a shift away from fossil fuels. Renewable power is not a new thing. These are the windmills here in Holland that have been grinding pigments since the time of Rembrandt and still are. There's solar panels that make plenty of electricity. These are the ones on my cabin, actually, when the sun does shine. There's solar hot water. This is actually in the occupied territories of Palestine, where people are, you know, making hot water from the sun. Solar water pump. Wind power. It's Altamont Pass, which was the first of the big wind farms. Lots of different kinds of forms of it. Yeah, there's good old fashioned people power, like the parking lot and the railway station in Hill Street. We also have the capacity to regenerate the land. And to do that, again, we call on Brighid to help us, because one of the keys to bringing land alive is water. And even in the best of times, we have a very long dry season. Around the world, globally, desertification is one of the big issues, one of the things causing extreme poverty and lack and famine in many, many places, degradation of the land. And the good news is that we actually know what to do about it. And the things that we need to do about it are most of the time can be done in a way that's simple, that's low tech, that individuals and communities and people can do with a little bit of training. It doesn't require an engineer, the Army Corps of Engineers. There are things like creating infiltration ponds and swales, which are ditches on contour with a berm to infiltrate the water into the earth. There are dry land strategies, like this village in Jordan, which is capturing all its rainwater now, and where people are planting in wells with mulch and in ways that capture water and reinvigorating the earth and the soil. There are ancient techniques like terraces, and there's even the simple capturing of rain off your roof to water your gardens. There are cailleagh systems that involve building ponds and plowing on contour. The cailleagh plow puts a deep groove in the earth so that when it rains, the water infiltrates deeply and it can regenerate damaged soil. There are water landscapes like this one in Tamara Eco Village in Portugal that are rehydrating the whole region. So we have this capacity and understanding that water brings life. When we rehydrate the earth, we are helping to heal the water cycles and the water holding capacity of the land. And one way to think about climate change, you know, is to think beyond just global warming. Climate change really, I think, is a symptom of a whole set of dysfunctional relations. Dysfunctional ecological relations, dysfunctional political and social relations. And many of them go back to water. So Brighid, I think, would tell us, replenish the well, rehydrate the earth, save the water, respect the water, clean the water, cherish the water. And when you do that, you begin to heal the whole cycle. Because when you heal the water and you infiltrate the water into the earth, that opens up the potential for healing the soil. And when you heal the soil, when you create fertile soil out of dead soil, you're putting what back into it? Gardeners out there? Humus, remember the humus, right? Same root as humility. Being close to the earth. And humus is a big fat molecule that's kind of like a docking station. You know, like in those outer space movies where all the little things are coming in and out. It's got multiple ports for holding on to nutrients and minerals. So when you've got a soil full of humus, you are holding on to all the things that plants need to grow. And you know what humus is? It's carbon. When you have a living soil, it's full of bacteria and full of fungi and full of little microorganisms and being life forms from this planet. Do you know what their bodies are made of? Carbon, right? So when you build healthy soil, you're increasing the amount of soil organic carbon. And where does that carbon come from? Comes from the atmosphere. And how do you get it into the soil? You know, what's his name? Branson, a guy from Virgin Airlines, at one point was offering like a $25 million prize for someone who would come up with a machine to take carbon out of the atmosphere and sequester it. And you kind of want to go, hello, Richard. There is a machine that does that, that has actually been doing it for 600 million years or more. It's called plants. And when you sequester it in the soil, you can do that again in ways that don't require like a $100 million grant from the World Bank. You can make compost. start making parts. You can sheet mold, which is like making vertical, sort of horizontal compounds. Yeah, worms are great soil builders and builders of beneficial bacteria. You can make a compost tea with compost and worm castings and other things. I often tell people that's my Harry Potter moment when we do it. It's potion making, 101. Now you understand really what the Eye of Newt was actually about. Probably had some, you know, important, you know, micronutrient in it that plants need. You can make biochar. Have you heard about biochar? It is charcoal made, that can be made from the things that you do when you're trying to keep the forest healthy, or from waste, cardboard, or newspaper, or anything with a lot of carbon, and you burn it in a low oxygen environment, and it makes charcoal. It makes a kind of charcoal that has multiple little pores in it. So if you grind that up and you add it to your compost and you put it in your soil, what it does is it becomes like a hotel for beneficial microorganisms. So it makes very, very rich soil. There are soils in the Amazon that are hundreds of years old that are built on this biochar. In an area mostly in the tropics, you know, soils are tend not to be very good in the tropics. The fertility is not in the soil, it's held in the biomass because the tropics it's hot, it's warm, and there's rain, and all that warm water washes the nutrients out. And in these biochar soils, those nutrients have been held for hundreds of years. You can partner with the fungi. Fungi underground are like a network of mycelium, these long little thread-like structures that hold the soil together and that exude things. They can break down toxins. And those little fungal threads are made of carbon, right? And they greatly increase the fertility of the soil. Paul Stamets has written a wonderful book called Mycelium Running, and he's sort of the wizard of the fungi. He's discovered all kinds of ways that they can be used for bioremediation, for health, for so many other things. So bioremediation, those ways that we can actually heal toxic and damaged soil. With compost, with worms, with fungi, compost tea, mushrooms, by growing special plants, there are many, many ways that we can heal the damage that we've done. And the wonderful thing is when we make up our minds that that's what we want to do, it's like we have these incredible allies everywhere. And most of them are some of the smallest, the most despised things. The worms, right? The microorganisms, the fungus among us, you know, but they are the great earth healers and the great planetary chemists, and they are always, always working for the side of survival and regeneration. Brighid is also the protector and the midwife of the flocks and the herds. And now you have to see keep pictures of sheep. Nothing cuter than baby lambs. But Brighid, as the midwife, you know, really understood this when we began to keep sheep and goats. And on our land, we don't have this exactly the same climate as Ireland, but it's similar enough that at Imbolc, in the beginning of February, which is Brighid's holiday, which means, comes from Boimel, which means ewe's milk. And suddenly it all made perfect sense because that's when the sheep are giving birth. You see the hooves poking out there. And there they are. There's nothing sweeter than you sort of chuckling at their lambs and licking them off when you're born. So, Brighid, as protectors of the herds, would tell us, I think, that there is a way, again, that we can regenerate the landscape on a large scale using sheep and goats and cattle, grazing them in ways, it's called holistic management, range management, that mimics the way the herds behave in nature in the presence of predators, where they bunch together for protection and they move along the landscape quickly. And the grasslands actually co-evolved with grazers moving in that way. This whole system was developed by a guy named Alan Savory, who was a ranger in Zimbabwe and loved the bush, loved the wild places, and saw them degrading and degrading and degrading. And they couldn't figure out why. They tried all kinds of things. They thought it was overgrazing, so they moved all the cattle out, and the land degraded faster. They thought there were too many elephants, so they moved the elephants out, and the land degraded even faster. And finally, what he realized is the grasslands need the impact of those animals, especially in areas with dry periods. They need the animal hosts to stomp the grass down, and they need the poo and the pee to fertilize the soil, and they need, but they need them to move in, do that, and move out quickly. Not stay there and eat the grass over and over and over again. When they do that, and the grass has time to recover, then it regenerates very, very quickly, and it can build soil very quickly, and it can build up soil organic carbon very quickly. And when you store the carbon in the roots of grasses, and prairie grasses can be 20 feet deep, you can store enormous amounts of carbon in forests, but you're always at the risk of a forest fire. Fire comes through, the massive carbon is in the trees and the trunks and the branches, and it goes back into the atmosphere. When you store it in grasslands, the massive carbon is in the roots, and even if a fire comes through, the mass of it is still there, and the grass regenerates. And grasslands cover an enormous area on the earth. They are the areas that are the margins of the deserts like the Sahara that are rapidly desertifying, but they are also the areas that can be brought back really rapidly using these kinds of techniques. So what we do is we bunch our sheep and goats together using electric fence and then move them every day, sometimes twice a day. We also pasture them, we also walk them back and forth like old kind of shepherds, and that way they graze stuff down hard and move on quickly. And so when people talk about geoengineering, we might get to the point where we need, we need to put iron filings into the ocean, or we need to shoot sulfur dioxide into the atmosphere, and we won't have blue skies anymore, but it'll cool the planet. It's like those people are sort of insane. They are like the inherent. What would Brighid say? Brighid would say, "No way! Are you out of your mind? We don't need that." What we need are all of these different techniques that work in harmony with nature. And when we do that, we do have the capacity to bring an enormous amount of carbon out of the atmosphere. But we have to first stop putting it in. We have to leave the tar sands oil in the ground, because if we actually exploit the oil and the tar sands the way the oil companies want to do it, the estimate is we'll raise the Earth's temperature by 6 degrees centigrade. We've already raised it by something like half a degree, and we're seeing the polar ice gone in the summer, the ice caps melting, the increase in storms, the increase in floods, the droughts, the weather patterns, all of those things. If we raise the Earth's temperature to that point, we are really talking about bye-bye civilization and bye-bye to a lot of the things that we most love and most hold dear. We're not talking about the end of the earth, because the earth is incredibly resilient, and some people, nothing else will be bacteria, and then another few hundred million years, they might evolve again into something with, you know, more of a capacity to create great art and bad video games, but I personally, you know, think that would be a terrible waste, and that we should have enough collective intelligence among us to avoid that. So we need to preserve what is left that is pristine in the world, first and foremost. And that includes what's left of the great forests, the boreal forests. These wild and beautiful areas that hold those amazing animals. That biodiversity that creates that incredible web of life on the planet. The global forests are an enormous carbon sink, one of the most important ways that carbon gets taken out of the atmosphere. And they cover a huge amount of Canada. And I think what Brighid would say to us, Brighid, who is also the protector, would say, we need to guard them, we need to protect them. We can also mimic them. We can also find ways to grow food in perennial systems and food forests that mimic natural forests, but where everything in it is something that actually contributes to either meeting a human need or meeting the need of the system. That's a Mediterranean version on my mind. So, I'm going to sing along again. Holy well and sacred flame. Can you imagine how that would feel? Well, we need to do that. And to do that, I think we need to call on Brighid, who is, again, that spirit of generosity. We need to call on those values that she represents to say, okay, we actually need a different ideology in our world. This belief that somehow it's all about profit making and privatization and individual getting theirs is leading us down a bad path. We can all see that, we know that. We need to go back again to those values that every religious tradition has taught us, that we are responsible for each other, that we are responsible for giving back to the world, not just for taking. That's what the Indigenous people, First Nations people say over and over and over again. You know, that we are responsible for caring for the elderly, that we are responsible for educating the young people, we are responsible for taking care of the sick, and that is those are the first things we should do with our wealth as a nation, as a culture. You know, they shouldn't be the last things on the agenda after, you know, the 5 billionaires get their yacht, next yacht. They should be the first ones.
Because those values are core to us.
politics is always about what we most deeply care about. And we talk about it only in terms of economics and drug policy and stuff. We aren't going to be really hitting people or where their hearts are. So Brighid, again, who constantly gave to the poor, who constantly, you know, took from the wealthy and distributed, who gave to the lepers, to the most despised in society, I think she would be telling us, we need to take care of each other. You know, we need to counter this inequality, where of this recession that we had recently. You know, bad as it was that during the Bush years, 65% of the wealth went into the top 1%, the wealth expansion. In the Obama years, it's been even worse. It's been 95%. Again, I think what Brighid would say is, that's wrong. And if you look at this graph, and this graph doesn't even really completely reflect the reality, because really that top layer is much, much thinner and much, much wider. But you can see this, you know, if that were a champagne glass, it's missing its bottom. It's not stable. And this inequality ultimately is not sustainable. It's not stable. As my mother might have said, this will end in tears. So, may Brighid's fiery fingers touch our tongues, filling our lives with wisdom, beauty, and transformation and inspiration. We need to regenerate our cities. Much as I love wandering around the land of the sheep, the truth is that most people live in cities, and cities are the places that we need to make big changes. And one of those changes is to localize. In Cuba, when the Soviet Union collapsed, they basically ran out of oil. They lost their imports and they lost their market for all their exports. And they say the average Cuban lost a third of their body weight in that first year. But what Cuba did was, there were some permaculturalists and agroecologists who lived there and advised them, and they began growing their food close to their cities. So for a while there in the 90s, something like 90% of their food was grown in and around the cities. Agroponicos, big organic gardens close to the cities. That used to be true of all cities when transport wasn't as cheap and easy as it is now. You know, London used to have huge market gardens south of the city, when it was a big city in the 1800s of like over a million people that was fed by the local area. And we need to get back to that. There's, any of you heard of the Transition Town movement? It's a movement that started in England. Actually started in Ireland, in Kinsale, with a course that a guy named Rob Hopkins was teaching in permaculture, and he had his course come up, do a design project to come up with a way that the town could take the resources it had and make the transition to a low-carbon future. And then he went back home to Totnes, a little town in the south of England, and started a movement. And now there are transition town groups all over the world. And the idea is you get together with your friends and your neighbors and you say, well, what can we do in our town or our neighborhood? What are the resources we have now? How do we build community resiliency for the future? And how do we relocalize things? And you know, economically, they say it's not how many dollars come into the community that determines its actual wealth and well-being. It's how many times each dollar changes hands before it leaves that community. So if you've got lots of people coming into your town to shop at Walmart, that's not doing much for your local economy, because all that money's going in and going right back out. But if you have people coming into your downtown and you're shopping at 10 different little stores there on the way and they're buying at the local farmer's market, then that money is going to support other things that are happening locally, and that money is going to change hands many, many times and create much more benefit. So in this neighborhood, Crouch End in London, they have a supermarket where they've got food from the sky. It's food that they actually grow right on top of the supermarket.
Oh.
It really just doesn't get much more local than that. Their community gardens is a huge movement all over the world. This is one that I've worked in a lot in San Francisco's poorest neighborhood called Baby Hunters Point. It's the last vestige of an African-American community in our city. And we've worked with girls teaching them to grow food and eat healthy food, although I can't say they always like healthy food. But they're trying. So community, if there's one word that's the antidote to climate change, it's community on every level. And I think one of the most imaginative groups I know of is called City Repair in Portland, Oregon. And what they do is they have taken intersections and turned them into gathering places. Because they look at our modern cities and say, you know what, we don't have places to gather. We don't have the piazzas and the plazas and village center. So they actually started this first one. It's called Sherritt Square. The street is Charlotte, and they changed it to Sherritt. And they first did it as kind of a civil disobedience, direct action. They just went out and painted the street. But since then, what they've done is they've worked with the city, and they've actually gotten a policy where you can create one of these in any intersection if you get the four people on each corner to agree and 80% of people within two blocks either way. And this one has a lot of wonderful things. It has a tea station where somebody always keeps hot water. You can get a cup of tea any time of day or night. It has a bus with wings that goes around and creates instant gathering places in there. And Bridget would really like this. They do a village building convergence every year. In fact, they're doing one right now where people come from all over and do natural building projects and do projects that bridge public and private space. And this one is the poetry station, where anyone can leave a poem and you can open it up and go in and get a poem anytime, day or night. And sit there on the bench and read it. And this one is Sunnyside Piazza, based on the sunflower pattern. This one, they wanted a labyrinth and a place to do community ceremony. So I think Bridget's flame is a flame of inspiration. And it's also a flame of passion, passion and action. So how do we get to this wonderful world where we are working on this all together? You know, how do we get to that point where we make the collective shift to say, yes, we're going to do it, you know, we're not going to let the powers that be stop us, we're going to move forward, and we're going to create the world that our children can really live in and thrive in? We got to organize. There's just, unfortunately, there's no way around it, because personally, like, I would much rather garden or watch TV or swim in the reservoir, do 10 million other things than organize. But there is something about organizing that you just have to do it if you want things to change. And when you do it, there also is an excitement. And I think organizing itself is part of the spiritual path. So how do you organize? How do you advocate for something? There are many different modes. You know, might be lobbying, might be campaigning, might be working with the media, it might be building coalitions. Sometimes you just have to stand up and say, stop. So there's the path of resistance and protest. Saying no to the pipelines, saying no to the oil companies, And we've seen really inspiring examples of people doing this. Climate justice movement, 350.org. That was when they called on everyone to go out and make a 350 with your bodies and take pictures of it. And my little country affinity group went out and did that in hundreds. But the reason for 350 is that 350 parts per million is what reputable scientists estimate is probably the safe level for carbon before we start getting to tipping points and runaway climate change. Currently, we're at about 400. And, so we are beyond the point where we can afford to put these changes off for another couple of decades or another generation. We are at a point where we really have to do this yesterday. And if we can't do it yesterday, we have to do it today, and then we have to employ all those methods of taking carbon out of the atmosphere, of repairing our ecological cycles and regenerating our landscape to bring us back to the point where we're not heading for ultimate disaster. We can stand with the Indigenous people who have really, again, First Nations people have taken the lead on this, have blocked the pipelines from going through British Columbia with unprecedented kind of agreements, have been blockading trucks in Montana and Nebraska, have really been putting themselves on the line. And they're really an inspiration, I think, to all of us. Many of us may not be Indigenous. I think of ourselves as Indigenous in our heritage. But many years ago, I was at the World Social Forum in Brazil, and I went to the Indigenous tent, and a man was speaking there from a community in Mexico, and he was saying, what does it mean to be Indigenous? He said, it's not necessarily just the color of your skin. It's not necessarily even being raised in an Indigenous way. To be Indigenous is to take the responsibility of being a guardian of the earth. And I really have carried that. So even though we may not think that we're Indigenous, we all come from people who were Indigenous somewhere. We all have that in our heritage. And in some sense, Brighid represents the Indigenous wisdom of the peoples, the Celtic peoples, and the pre-Celtic peoples. That wisdom that said, fire and water, really, really important. And we can all become, if not Indigenous, we all can become and take up that mantle of becoming the guardians of the land. And we can be allies of those who are standing on the front line. So there are many aspects to organizing. These are the stages of the campaign that Martin Luther King laid out. There's research and investigation. There's education, negotiation, mobilization, direct action, transformation. And I think sometimes we have to ask ourselves, what are we called to? We might not all be called to every aspect of it. There are times in your life where you might be the frontline direct action, sitting in the road person, and there may be other times where you're like, I'm a little older and prettier, and I don't know about that, but I sure could write those letters, or I sure could do that research, or I sure could help organize that meeting, or I sure could try to be on the phone and link up this person and that person and help build the coalition. I think there are many, many ways that people can be involved in making this change. So we do need the research and the data. That's my stepdaughter, Juanita, who's doing a research project for her doctorate in Switzerland on the effect of climate change growing plants in Switzerland. And this is a research project we're doing on our ranch of really being able to monitor and document how our grazing systems are going to actually impact the land. And it is important to get that data. So if you are the data type person, if you are the research type person, if you are wondering what to do with your life and thinking about how do I get an education, I encourage you to think about that. We need to do a lot of education, a lot of teaching, a lot of spreading the word to children, to young people, to officials. Some people with Brandy Allen and Mary Purple at a place called OUR Eco Village near Duncan in British Columbia on Vancouver Island. I was just there teaching the permaculture course. And one of the wonderful things they've done in that eco village is not just building these fabulous hobbit house-like natural buildings, but actually educating their officials to get them permitted, get them legalized, and to change mortgage structures. So that they can actually have a mortgage that works for an eco village. And, discovering what are the policies we can lobby for? What are the policies that are going to encourage this transformation? We can change policy often locally. San Francisco, for example, we now run our buses on biodiesel, which is made from the grease. Used grease from the restaurants. It's taken and turned into the fuel for our buses. Mm-hmm. And those are, I remember when I first heard about that in a permaculture course 10, 15 years ago, you could run engines on vegetable oil, I thought we were making it up. That can't be true. Now it's policy in our city. And every time we change policy locally, we create a model for other people. You can run for office. There's my friend Sharon Jackson, who ran for office in Duncan 20 years ago and has been on the city council ever since. That's how the right wing took power in a lot of places, was running for things like school boards, at least in the United States. Or things that, I'm not sure how it works in Canada, but the US, we have lots of little things that people pay a lot of attention to, like the water board. Transit board, but actually make really key decisions. I mean, the water board decides who can develop undeveloped land because they decide who can get a water hookup and who can't. And the transit board can make a decision to run the buses on biodiesel or make sure we have more buses so people don't need their cars. You can build alliances and coalitions. Earth Ethics Training is one of the groups that I'm the director of that teaches permaculture with a grounding spirit and a focus on organizing and activism. And we've got a long-standing alliance now with the Black Permaculture Network that was started by Pandora Thomas, who's the wonderful woman in the picture, who also teaches with us. And together, as we build these alliances and coalitions, we can support each other, we can share resources. We can really build a broad and diverse movement, and that's really important. We can find resources and funding and channel them to programs that help make the transition, like this one that we worked with in Baby Hunter's Point, which is teaching permaculture and horticulture and gardening to at-risk young people. So, I think, let's take a moment and let us sing along. Holy well and sacred flame. Part of telling that new story, part of making that shift. And when we make that shift, I believe that we can heal the waters, we can heal the land. One of the stories I always liked about Brighid, now I'll close with, is the story of Brighid's mantle. And the story is that she went to a chieftain and said, I need some land to build my monastery. And he said, no! Didn't want to give it to her. Finally he said, I'll give you as much land as your cloak will cover. And some version of the story, she throws her cloak on the ground. One version that I like is she calls her maidens to come. And before her maidens come, and they each take a corner of the cloak, and they run as fast as they can in the four directions, and the cloak stretches, and it stretches, and it stretches, and it stretches, until it covers the entire countryside. And that's the story I think that can inspire us right now, because if we think of Brighid's mantle as the mantle of healing, the mantle of life, the mantle of fertility, then we can become her maidens. We can take that mantle out into the four directions.